Nina Gordon. Louise Post. Veruca Salt. And me, and you, right now. You were a band that played in the 90s, as was me and my gang as well. So we're all three in that box. That was a decade that had great velocity with music. Bands are coming out and the music is driving, and you all were part of that. And so American Thighs comes out, and almost immediately you all have a single that lands. So my question to you is this: you walk into the 90s, not at the beginning of it as a recording artist, but when it's kind of Lollapalooza is already a thing, and in comes Veruca Salt. So you stepped on a very fast moving train with a single that everyone said, we'll take that. And you had great success early on. What was that like? Like, well, here's our record, and you're kind of in the fast lane as far as like an indie band. So what was that like for you all?
Well, I mean, it was all we knew. Like, we did not have the experience that so many bands had.
Knocking yourself out in the clubs for years and years and years.
I mean, we played a few shows, and then all of a sudden people were flying in from Los Angeles to hear us play at a tiny little club in Chicago or at South by Southwest in Austin. And but it's all we knew. So it was thrilling. And then it hit us that it was overwhelming and terrifying. But at the beginning, it was just like, hey, this is great.
Right.
You know, it was amazing. But it was, we didn't get to really, we cut our teeth, like, in public and on MTV. And so that was hard because we weren't really a seasoned band yet.
Right.
Yeah, and we got a lot of shit. Like, we had, like, a moment where we were like the coolest thing in town, and then all of a sudden we went on tour, we came back into town, and we were like the sellouts that, you know, in Chicago, like holier than thou indie rock scene was just like, oh no.
Well, there's a blue collar ethos there, and if you have not, you know, really paid your dues, then you are a sellout just by nature of having gained success. And I think that was something we also didn't know we were stepping into. But Nina and I had been you know, here I am still defensive after all these years. We had been in our living rooms writing songs and playing together for like, what, 2 years before we ever played a show. And a year and a half before we met our bass player, Steve. So we were sort of honing our sound and figuring out who we were. But we were influenced by all these bands that were already doing something, like Nirvana and the Pixies and My Bloody Valentine and these bands that they were already out there. They were really, really influencing what we were becoming quickly, you know?
So let's change direction a little. Let's talk about the city of Chicago, because you all are basically a Chicago band. And Chicago, as you all know, there's no city like it in America. It's the hub of the Midwest. It's an amazing city. It's a music town. It's got a history of music. So what's it like being in a city where the audience has an opinion, the music journalists have an opinion, and all the other bands have opinions with an intellect to back it up, talent to back it up, and they're not always all that friendly? I mean, I've been subjected to it, and ow, it hurts.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Well, yeah, I mean, that goes back to the sort of backlash thing that happened. Like, so we, early on when we played shows, nobody had any sort of perception of us. We played in tiny, tiny clubs, and I don't think there even were openers. It would just be a lineup of, you know, six bands
right.
and play and whatever. And but later, there were bands that we kind of knew, like, oh, we're not as cool as Tortoise, or we're not, you know, like all these bands. But there were so many good bands that we worshipped.
Sure.
And we were so motivated and inspired by them, like Hum, who I guess technically were from Champaign, but that counts as Chicago,
sure.
right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Close enough.
Seam and Red Meat. And like, I mean, there were so many great bands that we loved. Triple Fast Action. But we knew who our people were. Like, you kind of knew, like, who likes you and then who doesn't.
Right.
And I don't know that we got shit from other bands.
I mean, we had like a posse. We Local H was one of them. We would bowl with these guys every Tuesday.
I love that band.
So we went, So we would call our friends, and all these bands went bowling together. And then we all went to see each other's shows, and we sang on each other's records, and we all dated each other. Like, it was just, you know, it was a scene.
The scene.
And it was like, there was like the Smashing Pumpkins, and then that we were like they were the seniors, we were the freshmen, you know.
So here's another question. You follow up American Thighs with Eight Arms to Hold You, which has yet another big single. And so is there any point where you all had the idea that there's too many cooks in the kitchen, where maybe the corporate cart is leading the artistic horse?
So we never felt like anyone was driving us artistically, but there was the pressure of singles.
Right, and we started second-guessing our instincts, right. And we started miscommunicating, and that was really the big problem for us, because we were kind of suffocating with the pressure of having to follow up, see there was something that was equally as big, to the point where we had a video made by this guy's, was it Steve Hamp, is that his name?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, who had done Beck's Loser and Beer Can videos, and we loved his aesthetic. We asked him to do a video for a song called Number One Blind, which was our second single on American Thighs. And he did this really creative, quirky video, and beautiful video in hindsight. But we had we panicked about it and thought it wasn't good enough to release. So we actually just pulled the video back, and the record kind of went black. You know, like, that was it. Like, that was our big push. That was our second single. And we panicked and said, we don't want to release this video. And it was just a weird moment of panic for us, because we were, at this point, in the pressure cooker. And we weren't necessarily making the right choices, you know, because we were second-guessing everything.
Which leads me to this, and hopefully I'll throw this out without blowing too much of the proverbial smoke. To me, American Thighs and Eight Arms to Hold You sound like 90s records. You know, just, you're like, you know, here comes the guitar, wham! And it's just a big, just big sound. And I like those records, truly. There's so many things about Ghost Notes that says to me there's a confidence there. There is restraint, knowing that we don't have to push everything into the red all the time. There's a maturity that's not old. It's just like, I really know what I want to say, I know what I want to play, and I know where I want to place emphasis on notes. And I think it's such an evolved record. I just think there's just a great journey that you all have been through that made you arrive at Ghost Notes, where, and I know we could spend an hour on the journey of Veruca Salt. We're not talking, we're talking. You know, there's a whole thing there, and everyone knows. But I think there is so many good things about this record that you all could not have done all those years ago with American Thighs and Eight Arms to Hold You. That is now possible for wherever you all are at in your state and station in life. And I hear that on Ghost Notes. It's like it really comes out that the confidence, a real beautiful thing is happening on that record. And so it's not a super new record, a couple of years old, but what were you finding getting back together again, rediscovering and getting and remembering that the uniqueness of the two of you together? What happened on Ghost Notes that you think was different this, you know, this time around, the collaborative energy that you all have?
Take it.
Okay, well, thank you. First of all, that's the nicest thing that I think we could hear. That's really lovely to hear. Thank you. We were so happy to be back together. We were just overjoyed. And all of the stuff that had controlled us before, and I think interfered with our creative relationship and our friendship, was gone. You know, it had fallen away because we had made peace with, I think, ourselves separately from one another. I don't think, I know. And then together, which was the ultimate healing moment for us. And beyond that, we got to make music again. Like, you know, it was incredible. It's like we got to have another go at it, another chapter that we, neither of us had anticipated. I think we both thought, okay, the coffin is sealed. We're moving on with our lives. Even after we made peace, we weren't sure if we would be making music. And then nothing necessarily beyond like some kind of reunion tour. But when we started singing it and playing together, it was very quick quickly revealed to us that we had more to say and more to do together. And I brought a song to Nina that she said made her feel like, oh, made her realize, oh, we're making a record now. The song called Alternica, which was very much about the time that we sort of grew up together. And so it was incredible. Like I was really floating on air the whole time we were making that record, because not only did we heal our outstanding wounds, but we got to heal all the stuff with the guys as well, with Steve and Jim, and become a band together. And as you know better than anyone, a band is like a family. And when there's a rift in the family, you may all go about your business and continue your lives, but there's always going to be that empty place. And we had this incredible chance to get back together and do it another album. And further to that, I still feel, I think, the most alive when I'm with Nina, when we're working on music, when we're making a record. I think that a certain part of us, a vital part of us, comes to life when we're doing that. Other parts of us come to life when we are taking care of our kids, being moms, doing the other things that we do in our lives. We certainly have other interests, but and passions. But the being together and playing music, it is a place of freedom, right? And the industry and the stuff that we talked about earlier, that didn't take that away from us. We still have the core of what we are and what we became together and what we developed together when we first met. We're still that now.